And now to the next keynote speaker. Matilda Tam is professor in design at Linnaeus University in Sweden, where she leads the development of a new research platform called Curious Design Change. Matilda, you are also a dear colleague and a friend of the house. Matilda's work sits in a creative, positive, and activist space between design, future studies, and sustainability. Your work is informed by the notion of meta-design, design that supports complex collaborations and design for change. Today, Matilda will creatively and critically explore the man-madeness of the systems we live by and design's agile dance with them. Matilda, you are an important voice in today's fast-growing body of research in design and sustainability, and we feel honored that you happily accepted to give a keynote presentation here at the Redo conference. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Anne-Louise. Thank you. And thank you so much, Kegge. And I'm just going to get myself some water. I am so excited to be here, and I have to confess that when Anne-Louise emailed me a year ago, I wasn't exactly hard to get. I think I emailed by like return within a few seconds, and I feel really honored to be in such fine company here. And I'm going to try to talk about how designers can free design. And so recently I started hot desking in London, and a few days in, a guy called Steve asked what I do, and I said, I work with transformative experiences. And then Steve said, I think we have something in common. I work with psychedelic experiences. And it turned out that he sells magic mushroom trips to Holland. So this is my brag slide to make you feel safe. Originally, I'm a fashion designer, and over in the late 90s, I felt that I had a dilemma, that my passion for fashion wasn't compatible with my growing awareness of the effects that fashion has on people and planet. Simultaneously, I heard of a Swedish famous graphic designer who was going to leave design to become a medical doctor to do something real. And that made me really angry. I felt there must be a possibility for me to do something real and meaningful from design. So that took me to Goldsmiths and a master's, Design Futures, and a PhD. And since I worked with Professor John Wood at Goldsmiths, and he has given me so much, not least meta design, I still work for Goldsmiths. And today I also work with Sara Hiltén-Cavallius and her team at Linnaeus University, where I develop a research platform. And I've also been part of launching two new degree programs, Design Plus Change and Visual Communication Plus Change. I have two young daughters that give me so much, and what they also give me is the presence of a future where I sort of hopefully won't be a part, but I still have to work for. And they also remind me of the absolute necessity of playing in the context of sustainability. So this is the icy cold water of unsustainability that we dip our toes in. And I feel scared, I feel fear, and I feel frustration that not more is happening faster. And I also feel, thank you, a lot of hope when I see you, when I see my colleague, when I see Kegge, when I see all the fantastic people are doing amazing work. And today I want to take this question into what is freedom, how we can practice practicing freedom, freedom and sustainability, I promise you a talk on sustainability, and design as a freeifier. So every morning at 8 o'clock, three alarms go off on my three synchronized devices, my Swedish iPhone, my English iPhone, and my laptop. And the reminder is freedom, freeify. And it's there to remind me of the most fundamental, profound condition that I am free. I have the freedom to move. Something Hannah Arendt with The Human Condition recognized as the most fundamental of humans. Freeify is there to remind me that because I'm free, I also have responsibility to use my freedom. I have freedom to move, I must also use this freedom. And that means not planes and trains, but the responsibility to use my head, to use my thoughts, my actions, my creativity, my criticality, to try to open up new spaces and to try to be generous. So I want today to talk about an understanding of design as a practice of negotiating freedom. And by drawing this line around design, I'm also conducting an act of freeifying, but simultaneously, I'm also taking away freedom. Temporarily, we lose other understandings of design. I hope that's okay. So this is our space. This is the space we have. We have no other space. And this inside is the safe operating space. And often in the sustainability discourse, we talk in terms of reduction and limits and boundaries and don't do this. But within this space, there is freedom. Like the anarchist Hakim Bey said, the map is closed, but there are spaces. We can find these spaces where we have freedom, where we can do things. I want to explore these freedoms that we can open between us and the products we live with. I want to open up freedoms between us and the systems we live with, like the financial systems that actually are man-made, although we forget that sometimes. I want to open up freedoms in our paradigms, which concern power dynamics, how we understand what's valid knowledge. I want to free up. So in this talk, I want to explore how I can be a practitioner of freeifying and how designers can be practitioners of freeifying. What is freedom? So I think in this film, and I encourage you to watch the series, one very dominant narrative of freedom today, the car, presence itself, the car that can take us places, that also offers us a private space. Another freedom narrative that is more personal is that of singing in the shower or singing in the bath. And here these two narratives come together and they also collide when freedom of expression turns to shame. Other freedom narratives is about how we can look after bodily function and hide them so we can exercise freedom of movement and obviously also the free market, a semblance of freedom through spending money. And it's remarkable how old these freedom narratives are. So the L'Oréal campaign has been going on for about 40 years with many spoofs to testify to its stickiness, but also to its blatant consumerism and how patronizing it is. Of course I'm worthy, but not, I don't need it. And it's interesting how this individualistic path that these companies suck us into also take away our freedom, they take away our energy from participation. There are also narratives about how we can get freedom through simplifying our lives. At best, these are really good, but at worst, conspicuous consumption becomes conspicuous abstention. There are formal definitions of freedom. This is the first article of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And when I read this, I'm struck by a resemblance to the most famous definition of sustainable development from the Brundtland Commission in 87, which is sustainable development is the development that meets the needs of present generations without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their needs. And I'm struck by how both these definitions, really old, are still aspirations. Not just there, but also here. We are not sustainable and we are not free. Here or there. Nowhere. McSniff took on after Maslow's ladder and created a system of human needs that are universal, fundamental, which therefore apply to all humans across all times in all cultures. And he specifies freedom as one of these 9 needs. And we need to be autonomous, to have self-esteem, to feel passion, to be open-minded. We need to have equal rights. We need to dissent, choose, run risk, develop awarenesses, and this can happen anywhere. To me, freedom is stretching. Stretching can be delightful, but also slightly painful. We need to stretch our bodies to their fullest capacity. We need to stretch our minds to the edge of our understandings. We need to stretch our hearts and also sometimes realize the prejudices we have and the empathy we can develop. We need to stretch the systems and paradigms we live by that we have made and can change, redo. And I think of this stretching more as the stretching of a tree that attunes to its surroundings and the opportunities of sunlight and water than the forceful hammering of, for example, the war against terrorism. So I want to offer some gestures of practicing freedom. Double practicing, because they are practices, attempts. This is not about being heroes, this is trying to practice freedom. The first is the meringue, freeifying a ritual, and meringue is a wordplay on marriage. When I had asked Duncan to marry me 5 times, I realized it was not the me in the question that was wrong, but the marry. Duncan really didn't feel it was right for him to have our relationship blessed by religion or state. But we both like rituals. So we designed a ritual and we had our celebration in some woodlands that we share with other people. It was very difficult to design a ritual with the dignity and gravitas we needed, but what helped was that the 180 friends and members of family that came, they believed in our ritual. So together with them, we could freeify some of the systems we live by. Curious design change, freeifying design research. So in 2013, I had a beautiful opportunity of starting work at Linnaeus University under the leadership of Sara Hiltén Cavallius. And I was offered the task of setting up a new research platform. I think it's fair to say that at the time, the Department of Design was something of an underdog on the Swedish design map. There was so much competence and creativity and energy, but there was also a lack of confidence. So we set about doing some work together. We engaged all the staff in a co-creative collaborative process where we mapped future worlds and scenarios and set out a design research manifesto for ourselves. We surveyed our internal research and we also looked at what's happening in the world. And we put in place a design research course, design research in practice, to take the staff from thinking about research to doing research. Then we had the opportunity of engaging the London-based visionary design agency, Åbäcke. And I had a conversation with them that went something like this. Still very confused I was about what the research platform could be. So, what is a research platform? I think it is a platform for generating and sharing knowledge and stimulating and spreading curiosity. Isn't that a bit like a bookshelf? Yeah, let's make a shelf. So we got our staff together in a two-day event where we explored the concepts of design, research, and sustainability while simultaneously designing and making a shelf. And we used a tree, a spruce, from the local village of Eskås. And the spruce was auspiciously born after a storm in 1968. And this day was so important because it decentralized research. I was distinctly the least knowledgeable when it came to making a shelf. And it made my research, our research, all of us firmly embedded in the workshop space, the material processes. And then since we have launched the research platform within the university and with people around us, like the municipality and companies and so forth, fantastic event where we developed three research proposals. One of them was the Småland Living, Learning, Loving Lab, and that has brought together a lot of different initiatives around sustainability in the region. And then that has also led to two bigger funded research projects. One which is about the experience of aging, where we look at aging as a process that starts when we're born and we explore together with people of all generations. This is with Tokyo University. And another project which explores housing needs and opportunities at the intersection of migrant students and an aging population in the context of sustainability. So we thought that if we were to grow culture, confidence, pride, we would also sort of grow the more quantitative hard targets. We didn't think we'd need to worry about them. We should worry about the growing, the soft stuff. And that actually worked. And what we also hoped was that we would have meaningful research of value and relevance, and that we would be committed to collaboration and open up for collaborations, and I think that has happened. The best freeifier in this work was, I think, the term curiosity. We used curiosity to talk about research, and that decentralized, demystified, and democratized research, and made it open. We used change to talk about sustainability, giving us a direction, and also opening up for example, feminism as a very strong aspect of sustainability in the work that we do. And we made a shelf. It's not so important now, the shelf, but it was very important for growing us and freeing up. The next project is Beyond Consumption, Freifying Social Material Relationships. Languaging can be described as the co-creative relationship between articulations, perceptions, norms, behavior, and actions. And we know that language has amazing power. The term genocide, which was coined by the Jewish-Polish lawyer Lemkin in 1945, made it possible to prosecute against atrocities of whole populations. The word snippa was coined by the Swedish Organization for Sexual Health and Rights, and it means vagina. Before that, there wasn't a common colloquial term for the female sex. When I was a child, we called it front bum. And this was a feminist initiative to work against taboos, shames, and make visible female sexuality. Both of these terms show the power of language in freeing up new spaces, making things visible, talkaboutable, and also actionable. To me, the terms consumer and consumption are especially itchy. They literally mean devour and destroy. They set up a dangerous dichotomy between users and producers. They colonize culture, education, and healthcare, flattening very complex relationships and making them the same, bringing everything into a market monologic. But worst of all, they're not future-proof. They don't stimulate new ways of thinking and doing that we need to have sustainability. So I've been exploring how I can intervene in socio-material relationships by replacing consumption. I've been doing loads of workshops with different people in industry and students, and we have come up with many terms that can replace consumer and consumption, such as adoptive parent, a gardener, a nurturer, which sets up entirely new relationships between us and the things and the people and the species we live by. I've been exploring how I can hijack popular texts that I write as activism and reappropriate sustainability. So I worked with Anne-Sophie Back and I repositioned her work in the context of sustainability. I've been exploring what I term distance jokes, which most profoundly are the bizarre alienation between humans and our environment. And on an everyday scale is the joke that I'm going to leave a small child behind, or that my partner is going to have a date with a supermodel. I've been exploring how we can speculate and make real fictions where we have free access to the things we should have, as a matter of course. Recently, I've been fine-tuning a workshop format where we go through the writing of haikus, making, mapping, drawing, painting, talking about our personal relationships with the things, the resources, people, other species. This has yielded a lot of insights into the sorrow we feel at not being more present in our lives because of stress. Also, it has yielded the enormous power of getting together, because even for laypersons, we have so much knowledge about resource use, and we have come up with an endless amount of new words, like, what if I were a water diviner that could sense the presence of water everywhere? Consumption and consumer is different from genocide and snippa. Genocide and snippa needed words collecting something that was dispersed so we could see it and act. Consumer and consumption is the opposite. I think we need to free up those words. We need to free up those practices from a market monologic. So therefore, we don't need one word. We need a million words that represent the true diversity of our engagement with socio-material stuff. This is the space we have. But we don't live in this space. We live in a fictional space of overconsumption and overshoot. We live in a space that doesn't exist. And I took the all the articles in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights that explicitly mention freedom and sort of arranged them in the same way as the planetary boundaries. Thank you, Mr. Rockström. Hope you appreciate it. And here, the safe space is not in the middle. Because we need to stretch our freedoms. So the more stretching, the better. The green space is far out. And when I look at these articles, I feel we're not stretching our freedoms enough. We're not stretching our right to free education. We're not stretching our right of freedom of peaceful assembly. We're not maybe stretching our freedom of opinion and expression as much as we could. And I feel that there is a link to be made between these two models. I think that some of the freedom that we are not using makes us frustrated, and I think that some of that frustration translates into overconsumption and overshoot. Also, freedoms need exercising to be there. If you don't use public libraries, they will cease to exist. If you don't use free education, it won't be there. We need to use our freedoms and keep extending them so that they apply to everyone, everywhere. Obviously, freedom is related to responsibility. And we can see that a very small child has limited freedom and also limited responsibility. It should measure up. How much freedom we want and need is also different depending on who we are and where we live and how it is. And in the amazing book, Goodbye, Mr. Muffin, the dying guinea pig looks back on a good life and he remembers the day he took his family on a big adventure. That was the longest expedition ever, to the furthest reaches of the world. And it was Mr. Muffin and his 6 children who went there. They went to the end of the world and saw there was an edge. And here you are, and here I am, here we are together. And we enjoy a lot of freedom, although that freedom is different for us in different places. But we do share a lot of freedom. And I asked my colleagues what they think about freedom and design. And Petra Lilja gave me a really nice definition, I think. Creativity is freedom and the important foundation of any designer's practice. In that sense, an educated designer already holds a lot of freedom. On top of freedom of choosing a career, freedom of expression, and freedom to act. A few weeks ago, we went on a march in North London, where I live. It was the anniversary of the Battle of Wood Green, when shopkeepers and citizens came out to stop a fascist demonstration. And the fascists have never come back to Wood Green. And on this day, at this celebration, there were some fantastic talks. And one woman was talking about how her friends, community around her, always tell her, oh, you always keep banging on about racism. And she had the best answer ever. Well, stop being racist then. Because we are all complicit. And I think the political landscape today makes it so clear that there is no middle ground. We are either for racism, or for sexism, or we are acting against it. There is no middle ground. If we don't create our own agenda, we are assigning somebody else's. There are so many barriers to freedom. Laws, rules, politics, standards, guidelines, institutional frameworks, bureaucracy, other man-made systems that we forget are man-made, and racism, and sexism, and ageism. Small children fall off benches, which happened to me when I tried to freeify between my work and family life and took a small child to a panel debate in Oslo and she fell off a bench in front of a 250-strong audience. People get angry when we try to change things. Once I made 30 people so angry that I had to take them through a writing exercise before they could even voice their anger. Maybe because things change is scary. I think sometimes the barrier for us to freedom in design is that we glance a little bit too anxiously at older, more established research disciplines. We have freedom, we should use it and not try to be like the natural sciences. Sometimes we're not free because we want to belong or be cool. There are social risks to freedom and freeifying. When we stretch, we also expose ourselves at our most vulnerable. Sometimes I fear that we wouldn't save the world just because it was all too embarrassing. But design can be a freeifier. Design can stay with the trouble, as Donna Haraway says. This is a design, a bag design for a pig and sister. And because the pig has four legs, it needs takes two pairs of shorts to make this design. And this is a student project by some of my BA students at Goldsmiths a few years ago. And it's about the fear of a lack of gravity. Yeah, so design can stay with the logic when the trouble is bizarre. The trouble is complex and bizarre. It's bizarre that men and women don't have equal pay. It's bizarre that the clothes are filled, the shops are filled with clothes when I have shoes and clothes for several lifetimes. It's bizarre that young people feel the need to change themselves. It's bizarre that we have certain leaders in the world. It's bizarre that we throw away a third of the food. The trouble is complex and bizarre. But design can stay with the trouble. We are very good at not accepting cliches of solutions and not accepting that policy or business model should go in the way. We actually enjoy taking a line for a walk, the risk of that, and see where it goes. Design can defamiliarize. And what's so important with that we can look at the bizarreness of the world and actually remember that although we've been conditioned to it, it is bizarre. And we can refamiliarize ourselves with new solutions. Designers are experts at negotiating freedom. Designers can know in many ways. And as much as I like to show family pictures, I've actually done that to show that we can draw on our personal knowledge, our personal experiences, our practices, our gut feelings. We have many ways of knowing. Designers can mix apples and pears and bananas and iPhones, and that's why we can really handle complexity. Designers can convene auspicious collaborations, and what we have seen is that it's easy for us to get people to come from other disciplines because we are such an underdog that they don't even have to be scared or pretentious. Design can point to spaces of freedom that are underused or are there to take. Designers can be pompous like me when I talk about freedom without being an expert, but that gets us a chance to talk about things that need talking about. And we can also cultivate our naivety and keep asking stupid questions. Designers can seriously play and laugh, and we all know how important the liberating laughter is. I want to end with the ballad of freedom and power of the younger generation.
It's time to see what I can do to test the limits and break the rule. No right, no wrong, no rules for me.
Thank you so much, Matilda.
Thank you.
I hope you feel free to accept this small Danish gift.
Thank you so much. Thank you. I'll come in.